Great. Thank you everyone for coming to our session today. We're really looking forward to hearing this talk on vendor partners in the Folio project. And so just a reminder, we are recording. You can also find the closed captioning and the transcripts below. Use the hashtag WOLFcon21 for your social media tweets, and use the Q&A for any questions that you have. So with that, I will turn it over to Jesse to get us started. Thank you.
Thank you, Beth, for getting us going. And give me a second here to bring up this. Hopefully you're seeing a slide. This is the slide for this session, I believe, unless any of you prepared any slides for your presentation. I want to welcome everybody to what we're calling a panel on vendor partners in the Folio project. We brought together four representatives of some vendors that are pretty deeply involved in the Folio project these days. There are many other vendor organizations doing work in the Folio project as working for implementing libraries, partnering on software development, and any number of other activities. We picked these four, and hopefully in the future, if this session is as successful as I'm hoping, we'll pick and choose some others in the future. And we'd love to hear from all the different vendor partners we've got out there in the Folio project. Folio benefits greatly from our vendor partners. It's they are essential players in this wonderful mixture we have of vendors and librarians and developers around the world that are making Folio happen. And I wanted to thank them all for joining us and not share my email with everyone in the process. So bear with me a second while I bring up my questions that I was gonna ask. How this is gonna work is I've got a few questions for each of the panelists, and they will they'll take turns answering those and may follow up with one or more of them if there's a thread to pick up on there. And hopefully at the end, there'll also be some room for some questions from the audience, particularly if there's something that people think we should cover that we have not been able to yet. So I want to start off, I randomly selected our order of panelists, and we're going to be starting off with wherever that went, with Sebastian. The first question is, tell us about how your organization engages with the Folio project.
Thanks, Jesse, and hello, everybody, and thanks for being here. So we were one of the original three stakeholders of the Folio project when it began way back when, and we're very heavily involved in both the technical aspects of the project to begin with, as well as the formation of the community. So we architected the overall model for Folio and built Okapi and Stripes, as well as the first 8 or 10 or so apps that went into the system. I think we actually helped convene the very first SIG meeting, which seems crazy given how many there's been, in Copenhagen, Denmark, of all places. We couldn't have done any of that without very bold and handsome support, financially and otherwise, from EBSCO. So huge kudos to them for taking a leap of faith on this project and this collaboration, as well as to the member libraries, the participating libraries, for their engagement. Today, our engagement and participation is entirely self-funded. So we are active in a number of different areas. My colleague, Mike Gorell, is chairing the new community council. We are involved in most of the councils that make up the governance structure of Folio. We participate in some of the documentation process. We lead the core platform team, as well as the DevOps team that manages a lot of the packaging of releases and some of the maintenance of the continuous integration subsystem of the project and so on. We also fund and lead the development of the library data platform. It's done by my colleague Naseeb Nassar, together with the FOLIO reporting community. And we've worked really closely with Ian Ibbotson and Knowledge Integration to help bootstrap the project we share, together with a really awesome group of library consortia and individual libraries as well. So there's a lot of different ways we participate, but honestly, thinking about this, in many ways, FOLIO has come because maybe 80, 90% of our activities at Index Data exist within the FOLIO realm. FOLIO very much feels like sort of an extension of our group. FOLIO meetings feel like just another part of our everyday work. I know that lots of our team members have friendships with people in libraries, people at different organizations. So it's become a community that we belong in and where we feel super happy to be.
Thanks, Sebastian. And I neglected to officially introduce everyone. So that was Sebastian Hammer, co-founder of Index Data. And next up, Ian Ibbotson of Knowledge Integration, or K-Int.
Thanks, Jesse. Okay, so I guess by way of a little bit of context, Knowledge Integration are an independent software vendor. We've been working in the sort of GLAM sector, galleries, libraries, archives, and museums, on an open source basis for 20 years. We go way back with Index Data, back further than any of us care to remember, I suspect. As a company, we've kind of traditionally worked in the cracks, I guess, is one way of saying it. An example of that, 10 years ago, we were talking to JISC about the challenges that librarians were facing managing electronic resources. The knowledge base problem was largely a solved, it was on its way to being a solved problem. But the institutional problem of managing your acquisitions around that, managing your renewals processes, managing cost per use calculations, all those things were really painful. And the library management system vendors were really slow to catch on to addressing that pain. And so we worked with libraries to build KB Plus as an ERM solution, which kind of had more of an institutional feel to it than perhaps the KB providers were focusing on at the time. And we've done similar work with things like open access publishing. So we're very much interested in kind of the cracks between modules, less interested in circulation and cataloging, those big library system pieces. I'm more interested in the glue pieces, that kind of quality of life thing for library staff and for patrons as well. So that's kind of how we've engaged with that. And we've been incredibly lucky to find in GBV a kind of partner development organization. So I think I classify what we do with licenses and agreements as being co-development in essence. GBV give us funding that let us concentrate on their problems with ERM, whilst also trying to produce the most reusable and most FOLIO friendly app. So we're really thinking with a kind of product focus when we're building agreements and licenses, and trying to make sure that we, the phrase kind of think locally, act globally, is that the right way around? So we're very much trying to do that in FOLIO, and the way that we do that, the way we engage with the project currently, is primarily through licenses and agreements apps. And we've been really gratified by the uptake of those apps. Obviously those apps are owned by the community, but I think we kind of feel a little bit of ownership of them and a little bit of love for them. We care about them a great deal. And we're really pleased that we're now able to do that with open access publishing as well, and our colleagues at Leipzig. So, FOLIO has been a very natural home for us. The kind of ecosystem around FOLIO and the idea of apps working together, it fits really nicely with our approach of trying to improve quality of life for librarians and make little apps which join systems together. I think, like Sebastian, we feel very much at home in this ecosystem, and particularly with the collaboration that's been built around it. I think that sums up where we are.
Thanks, Ian. And moving on to Ian Walls, Folio implementation lead at ByWater Solutions.
Yeah, it's still strange for me to have two Ians in a room. It's just, it doesn't come up that often in my experience. Hi, so I'm Ian Walls. I'm with ByWater Solutions. We are an open source support company for libraries. We've been doing this for 12, 13 years now. We've been in the Folio game for 2 to 3. Before that, most of our experience has been with Koha, one of the other open source solutions out there. Currently, we are supporting 4 libraries that are using Folio in production as their full LSP. Washington and Jefferson College, St. Vincent College, St. Thomas University, and Warner University. We know that the best way to support these libraries, to take care of our partners, is to be actively engaged with the community, the open source community getting out there. That means, in this context, attending council meetings, engaging with the SIGs and the product owners and the developers synchronously and asynchronously, and sharing our solutions, documentation, workarounds, ideas publicly, getting that back in there into the community. So we're very much engaged with what's going on in Folio and trying to be good community members, good participants. We are not formally members of the Folio project, the SMLLC that runs the governance model. But we are here and we are interested in making Folio be the best that it can be for our partners and for libraries beyond.
Right, thank you. And last up on this particular question, Anya Arnold, Manager of Folio Consulting Services at EBSCO.
Yes, and my name is Anya, and just to restate the question is to tell us how your organization engages with Folio. EBSCO has been one of the founding, along with Index Data, contributors to Folio. We have POs and Scrum Masters and development teams, as well as convener of SIGs. We're very much invested in Folio's long-term future and health. And we believe that libraries need choices in the marketplace and that Folio is the place for innovation for libraries into the future. That is a very short, quick answer to that question.
Well, excuse me, I'm going to stop sharing that slide to let everyone see our panelists live now. Next question is, tell us about your customers and any particular successes or maybe wow experiences you may want to highlight about them. And we'll shake up the order a little bit. Let's go to Anya for this one.
Oh, this is my favorite topic as I am in charge of implementation. So one of my favorite things is to get a library that has been doing the same workflow for years and even maybe have transferred those workflows from system to system to rethink about why they are doing those workflows. Because sometimes we just cut off the end of the ham because that's how grandma did it. And that's really not needed anymore because we have bigger hams, right? So it's really nice to see when we can either stop doing something or think about it in a different way. One of my favorite stories is actually from Chalmers, where they had a staff member that was unable to attend any training. And so their first day on the job was their first day using Folio. And this person had never had any access to Folio prior, and they were able to pick it up right away. So that was really kind of nice to know and validating from a service that it is is able to be used by people. I'm trying to find the word in my head and it's gone. But really, we want people to understand why they're doing the things that they're doing and to maybe rethink about the paradigm of what a library system is. So too often as librarians, and I am a librarian, we think of our ILS as the solution. And really it should be viewed as the tool that we use to get to the solution. And I think that is a complete paradigm shift for all of us that it's really highlighted with Folio and how we want to use it eventually. So that is really what I get jazzed up about, and I get really excited to see like Brooks from MSU, you know, being like stepping up to be the PO for InReach because he knows he can do it. You know, like all of those things are huge wins for the clients that I've been working with and for the community.
Thanks, Anya. We'll go in reverse order from the first time. So Ian Walls.
Sure. So about our partners, I've already gone and named them, but most of them are on the smaller side for libraries, the largest around 200,000 biblios, and some with as few as two people on full-time staff. Another has three. Came from a variety of legacy systems, Symphony, WorldShare, Millennium, and we brought them all up live in 2020. So I guess our primary wow experience was that we brought up three libraries on Fameflower and another on Goldenrod. These are really early versions of the software. These are not, this doesn't have the full set of features that we were planning on having with the MVP release. And these libraries are happy. They're able to do what they need to do during the day. You know, we meet regularly with them to check in. And yes, of course, there are some technical issues that come up. There are limitations to what the software is currently doing. But when we encounter those, we stop, we listen, we collaborate, and we come up with whatever kind of solution it's going to be it elegant or perhaps a little cumbersome, but temporary. So I guess my favorite example of one of these kind of things is we don't have the LDP for our partners. That's not part of the package we're offering. So our reporting options have been kind of limited up until now. So working with other members of the community, and I definitely want to give a shout out to John Miller at UChicago, because this is mostly based off of his work, coming up with a Folio native reporting view that when hooked up to an open source web interface, Metabase, allows us to run arbitrary queries against the data. So this has allowed me to cut my ticket response time by like 60% on a lot of these questions. They're asking for this kind of data. Boom, this is how we can do it. We can get that back to them in a lot shorter turnaround time. And we're in the process of making this a self-service operation so that we can reduce that time even further so they can get their answers and be that much more empowered around their data. That's really where we're trying to go with this, is making sure that our partner libraries are empowered to have control over their systems, to have control over their futures and their destinies. So I think that's the wow factor for us.
Thanks a lot, Ian. Ian, why don't
you go next? Yeah, thank you. I mean, so this is a really interesting question for us. Knowledge integration doesn't really have aspirations of being a hosting provider. So to answer the question, you know, how do we engage with our customers, any particular success stories? In the strictest sense, our customer is GBV. And so those are the people that I care about. But the reality of the situation is that GBV have funded us being a part of Folio. So in a very real sense, our customers are everybody who uses licenses and everybody who uses agreements. So it's not an institution, it's a whole range of institutions, and those are the guys that we care about. And to pick up on Anya's point, I mean, I think if we have a strength as a company, it's in really high quality sort of systems thinking and systems analysis and design. We want to think really hard about the domain model so that it's a good, robust model that will adapt to institutional change, not something that's going to brittle and break after 2 years use. You know, it's going to absorb the shocks. When CDL comes along, our domain models will grow and enhance that. And I think for me, that the best thing about Folio has been that GBV for us have been a partner that have actually listened. When we've asked provocative questions, they haven't said, no, this has got to be a Mark catalog based system that does X, Y, and Z. You know, they've actually stopped and said, what is it you're trying to say here? And let's work through this. And for me, that sense of community and having a genuine partnership with the libraries who are using the system and with people who are our customers, and our friends, actually. No, they're our friends first. And they're kind of our customers later, I think, now. Those relationships are just part of, sorry, a tangent for a second, another part of our business, we do work for Big Pharma. We do big data work for Big Pharma. And my fellow directors keep saying, why are we putting time and effort into this Folio thing? You know, those guys, they pay way better. And the reason that we carry on with this is because we absolutely love the domain and we love the people we work with. And that's just true for us. So I'll shut up.
And maybe you can move some of that Big Pharma money towards Folio.
That'd be nice, wouldn't it?
And Sebastian, anything about your customers, any particular successes?
So we have focused on offering a really wide range of different types of services for Folio, everything from project management over data crunching and workflow analysis to hosting for people that want to run the software locally to custom app development to cloud hosting in a SaaS model. So we've been really fortunate, I think, in getting an eclectic band of partners for our implementation services. I think we currently have around 16, about three of them in production and the rest in various stages of deployment over this summer, next summer, or next year. So that's really cool. I really value working with Lehigh and Duke and Chicago because they're complex libraries and because they've made just huge contributions to the Folio project. So getting to engage with them on sort of an everyday basis about their problems is really cool. I like that. I've also valued our partnership and our work together with GBV enormously. I can't say enough about the contribution that they've made to Folio through their collaboration with knowledge integration. And working with them, working with Leipzig University and the Saxon State and University Library is really exciting because the German Folio community is so vibrant. There's so much stuff going on. So many libraries that are looking at Folio, so many libraries that are investing actively in Folio. Some big part of that is just enormous good fun. It's really neat to be working with Spokane Public Library as one of the first public libraries in the US engaging. But I think my real wow experience is also the first one. Fenway Library Organization in Boston was the first organization to engage with us to implement Folio. And at that time, you know, we had known from day one in Folio that at some point we wanted to be Folio service providers. And we had worked to gear up to be able to play that role, but we were doing it as a leap of faith. And it was really Flo that took a chance with an unproven service provider and pulled us in. And I'm eternally grateful to them for that. And I just remember the first meetings. This was back in the face-to-face days. You know, we all pretty much convened on Boston and spent a week with them for the first time sitting around the table and saying, okay, we've had this thing living on whiteboards. We've been building this thing. How does it actually apply to people's everyday workflows? That was real moving. That was like one of those kind of career capstone, keystone types of times, just sitting with those people, working through those, figuring out that Folio actually had turned out to become a real library system. That was really awesome.
Well, thanks, Sebastian. I have a third question that I sort of prepared ahead of time, and we're moving through well, so it looks like we'll also be able to get to some stuff from more open in the session. But let's jump into that third question. We'll start in the middle of order this time. But let's start with Ian Ibbotson here. Like, how do you see your organization engaging with the project in, say, 3 to 5 years?
Yeah, I mean, this is the one that keeps me up at night. This is the pointed question that my fellow directors keep asking me about every month. This is a tricky one for us. I think, as I said at the beginning, knowledge integration as a company works in two ways. We do development work with libraries and we try and have long-term sustained relationships and get support revenue from people we work with. We're less interested in being a hosting provider. And so that's still a big question mark for us in Folio. Like what exactly is the model for independent software vendors? If I want to write a killer app for Folio, but I don't want to host Folio, what exactly is the route by which I can, you know, make a living and be able to maintain and support that application if I'm not a hosting provider? And that question keeps me up at night, as I said. But what I would say is, you know, I think EBSCO, they they've done a really amazing job in funding this initiative. And I hope that what I've just said didn't come as a shock to anybody at EBSCO, because I've said those things directly to Christopher and to Gart. And both those guys have actually listened when I've said this to them, and I actually feel heard. So again, as a partner and a vendor in this ecosystem, I actually feel like I've said to the organizations involved, well, this is an issue for me. And I mean, to be fair, I have some agency in this. I'm on the community council. You would expect me to be able to voice these concerns. But working out the shape of that is really important, because as we've worked on Folio with GBV and with the community, you know, we've started to have ideas. We've got ideas for apps we'd like to build, which are kind of like a little bit out there, you know, research data, all those things, things we're interested in. But we've not quite figured out what the model is yet, where we can contribute those, but also, you know, put food on our plates. So it, for the next year, the next 2 years, we're incredibly lucky. We've got long-term commitment from GBV. I don't believe GBV are going anywhere, and they will continue to support us doing this work. And I couldn't, you know, speak highly enough of that relationship, as Sebastian did. But kind of going out to 3 and 5 years, I don't really think it's fair for the community to continue to rely on GBV to pay for the maintenance of licenses and agreements, for example. So I would really like to understand more clearly what that model is in Folio, and how that can work going forward, and how you can you know, earn an honest crust if you aren't a hosting provider, basically, which is more of a challenge than a solution, but that's where we're at.
Thanks, Ian. I'm gonna jump around in the group. So Anya, you're up next.
Well, you know, EBSCO has a long-term commitment and view for Folio. We want to see Folio be successful, both as an open source product and, you know, community. And we're also, you know, going to support our clients that are live continuously, and to help work on their desired improvements, their desired, you know, features and functions that they want, that maybe the rest of the community will benefit from, but not, it's not really high priority for them. So there is like some flexibility within that. And that's a wonderful thing for an open source community to have. You know, long-term, you know, I got into this because I see the potential of Folio to allow libraries to, for it to be the last system that you migrate to, because it should grow with you. And that's really what is exciting. And that's what I think, you know, EBSCO is really interested in as well, as long as connecting other services and products to it, just like everyone else. So I think it would be, there's a world of opportunity here.
Sebastian, and then Ian.
Interesting question. So I think the first priority, number one, it's critically important for Folio to meet the operational requirements of the libraries that use it. And that's going to have to be the main priority. And it's very high on our list of priorities on behalf of our customers and for the community as a whole. But I also believe that Folio is and can be more than that. My whole kind of working career of about, 30 years or so in libraries has revolved around open source software and the dynamics of collaborations around open source software. And I have come to believe that open source software is a kind of magic sauce that allows organizations to lower their firewalls and sit around the same table and solve problems together. And that's, in that dynamic, really amazing things can happen. And I am addicted to being in that space, if you will. I also happen to think that kind of space and those types of collaborations are critically important for libraries to retain agency and to push back on the tendency of the library technology marketplace to collapse into monopolies. And I think that Folio happens to be a particularly mature example of how that magic sauce can be weaponized, if you will, can be formalized and scaled to enable lots of different kinds of organizations, commercial and libraries, to sit around the same table to form an ecosystem together. And I would like to be a part of keeping that ecosystem healthy for Folio, but I would also very much like to see that partnership within Folio or within collaborations inspired by Folio into other areas of the academy, if you will, research data, teaching and learning, all these different challenges that we have, scholarly communication that we have in this space. We want to explore and play in those. So for me, being a service provider is partly a means to an end. It's part of how I solve the problem of funding engagement, continued engagement. It establishes a baseline of revenue that I can build on to support collaborations and my own initiatives and collaborations with other organizations. But it's also an end in itself, because I also firmly believe that service providers and commercial partners have a real role to play in these types of ecosystems as kind of force multipliers for libraries, as a way to gather and focus the energy of many different libraries and sizes and types of libraries, and very importantly also to allow even tiny libraries with two staff members to engage in an open source community in at the scale and the level that's appropriate to them. So I'd love to be able to step in and say, hey, you don't need to have a DevOps person or a developer on hand to be participate in the Folio community. You can engage in all these different levels, and you can go out, you can buy in the services you need to complete the picture, but you have agency and you have choice. So that's where we want to be in this space, both contributing to and growing the community, but also being part of the mechanics and the substrate of that community.
Great, thanks. And Ian Walls.
Yeah, that's felt like a really nice transition. In next 3 to 5 years, our plan is to continue to support the partner libraries that we have, and hopefully to have brought some more folks on board. The more that we can do that, the more that we can scale our Folio operations and engagement here at ByWater. This is not our only open source offering. There are other products that we support that keep the company on its equal, stable footing, and we will grow our Folio engagement as our Folio investment grows. So we have a working model for how to be an open source vendor, how to be part of an open source community and make something that works for libraries. So we just, it's a matter of powering up the meter and stepping into that. So one of the areas that we're really good at is documentation education. So I would imagine that as we reach that scaling, that may be one of the first areas that we can start to power ourselves up and contribute more to the overall community in that area. Depending on candidates that we would get to fill staff positions, it may be other areas as well. So that's sort of our vision, is that we're here, we're gonna take care of who we have, and we're gonna help to keep things moving forward. And the more that we can do, the more that we can do.
Thanks a lot, all of you so far for this great info. There are a couple questions from the attendees. One particular one I think is a great one to leap off of from what we've just been talking about. And let's start with that one and then get to the second. But as the Folio platform matures, do you have any concerns about how the information technology may shift and the Folio project keeping up with the latest infrastructure tech? And anybody want to take a first stab at that? Ian?
Yeah, thank you. I was hoping we'd get to this one in chat. I mean, it is just such a key question. And the reason that I wanted to chime in here is I think, coming at this from the point of view of a very small development team with quite a laser focus on some particular modules, I really want agreements and licenses to be the best agreements and licenses for any library in any library management system. And like, I don't want that team to be hamstrung by a platform that's, stuck on technology stacks, which are, 2 years old. And so I think there's a lot of challenges in this question. For me, part of the answer is empowering individual teams to make sure that they can individually stay up to date and not trying to do this like a monolith. We've not used that word yet in this presentation, so mark that off on your bingo card. For me, it really is about empowering individual teams to make sure that they are up to date. And I think that your question is just great. When you look at GraphQL, I think is a currently trendy one. I think Stripes at some point, tangent again. Knowledge integration has been great. We have some clients who are still with us on day one. 20 years later, we have those clients. Their software has gone through UI refreshes and it's gone through some spring cleaning, but fundamentally the technology stack, the data model, the domain model has evolved over time. That's quite how we do that in Folio is going to be a challenge. And, you know, I look at how we do a UI refresh, which is the thing that really concerns me actually, because our UI layer has become slightly entangled with our middle layer. And that I look at that and I think, I don't know how we're going to get ourselves out of this right now. So I think it's just such a great question. But for me, the key is in empowering the teams to make sure that they stay up to date themselves.
I think it was also a key part of the conversation in the early days of the project. How do you try to empower individual teams to make their own technical choices as much as possible while retaining enough of a shared of a core? So the choice of leaning on microservices was really central to that piece. And not all of the implementation or execution may have been perfect, but the foundational principle of trying to avoid having Folio depend on any single big monolithic technology was really key. The UI piece felt like a hard one to avoid. And I would fully expect that there's going to be a major UI refresh at some point, and it's not going to be exactly painless, but it'll be necessary. But we are already seeing, I mean, if I look at the technical choices that were done on the back end, building the first apps, to what's being done in Project Reshare and what you've done elsewhere, and I think there's a substantial level of empowerment of individual teams. And we can thank, I think, technology for that too, right? In previous projects, you were kind of stuck leaning on some application environments. And I think containerization and cloud technologies have done a lot to enable teams to work more independently. And I think the project has more to do to learn how to orchestrate that, to learn how to make Folio still manageable, especially for smaller libraries that want to kick the tires and play with it. But I think that at least some sound choices have been done, so.
Yeah, I just would like to add that I think at some point we'll have to talk about, you know, technical debt and going back and bringing things up to date and or getting through that long list of technical debt that we have. And I do know, you know, as a former library director, you know, that would answer, or read RFPs for new systems that we were looking for. Some new systems, you know, they couldn't even hire, or not new systems, but systems couldn't even hire new developers to work on those platforms because the code base was so old. So at least having open source and, you know, a vibrant community, we can make sure that our code is up to date, as current as possible, and to keep focus on that technical debt and ensuring that our infrastructure is good. I know that infrastructure is not always a, you know, glamorous term, but it is what keeps everything running. So we do need to pay good attention to that as well as, you know, the fun features and functions.
And I'm just gonna say that everybody else has said this all very well. So I don't have too much to add to that aside from I'm certainly thinking about it. And I'm very grateful that this is built the way that it's built and we can look at how to sort of move things into place in increments and phases rather than having to move ourselves over to a completely different monolith.
Jesse, you're muted.
Welcome to Zoom. All right.
Yes.
Thanks, everybody. Let's take a couple minutes on this question that came up about the question is, thanks for bringing up the example of the library data platform or LDP. It seems that reporting might be an example where customers get different services. I assume depending on the service provider they're choosing. Is there any movement to have reporting functionality that is part of Folio and that any customer independent of vendor can have access to? There's a brief answer to this saying that LDP is also an open source and community owned tool. And hosting providers could use or not use that as they choose. But Sebastian, why don't you start on that one?
I guess there's a specific answer and a more general one. One of them is that LDP very much arose as a reporting solution for and by Folio. It was heavily guided by the Folio reporting SIG, which we think of as the reporting community. We since saw an opportunity to bring it to bear on Project Reshare too, which shares the same underpinnings. And quite honestly, in looking across these two projects, we started to see reporting as something that really had broader application. We saw an opportunity for a community-owned reporting solution that could be used not just to pull in and aggregate information from different microservices in your ILS, but could be brought used to bring in information from different parts of the library, different parts of the organization, even across consortial memberships. So LDP is currently bending its way past the process to become part of the Open Library Foundation as a separate partner project, if you will. That doesn't really take anything away from Folio, in my view. To the other part, the other question is, I think it's the reality that you will see different flavors of Folio unfold provided by different vendors, perhaps optimized for different sizes of libraries or types of libraries. And some of those may have limitations in terms of what software is included or not. So I think just as, to take another example, to look at Linux, which has been packaged by different organizations to meet different needs, optimized for different purposes, there will probably be flavors. I think Folio is too complex for there always to be sort of a single interpretation of what it is that will meet everybody's needs, especially as the number of applications and apps grows over time. So I think you may see vendors that specialize in providing access to absolutely everything you want, and you will see other places where choices are made. That's probably inevitable.
Anyone have a minute or so additional comment on that?
I would say that, yeah, this is one of the cases where there's going to be some of that tailoring. There's going to be, you know, using the app-based approach that Folio has, we can have, you know, customizations that fit in sort of a per library or are supplied per vendor. For a generic reporting solution, that's a wonderful idea to have be folded into Folio LSP, the product. That would really be a product council decision to say, okay, this tool is going to do this job and it's going to be bundled up in this Wildflower release. And whatever that solution is would be awesome. And it would be part of it. Until then, it is going to be up to sort of figuring out, all right, if it's not built into Folio, the product, how are we going to solve that issue and what's going to be the best solution? That's going to vary in context.
Just to add to the great answers that have been here, that we also need built-in reporting for everyday daily tasks in Folio. And I think that is something that we'll see coming in some later Wildflower release. But those things are really important to be in real time and for daily tasks that we do, you know, hourly sometimes that we're missing right now in Folio.
We're starting to see some of that, I think, with the ERM dashboard, which is not meant to stay only in ERM. I believe it's got an architecture that can be plumbed onto another place.
Absolutely, yeah.
Any last words? We got about 30 seconds.
I think that the other thing about the reporting is, like so much of Folio, we're ahead of our time. There was no single SPA multi-front end framework when we started, so we made stripes. And I think the same is true of data lakes. Delta Lake as a product, as an open source data lake aggregation tool, didn't exist then, so we've got this solution. Maybe in another year, it will be as crazy to think about not using Delta Lake as it is to think about, you know, not using Postgres. We wouldn't implement a relational database if we were doing this today. I think it's just that reporting in microservice environments is a very new thing, and the tools will catch up with us and are catching up with us. So I don't think people need to worry too much about that. The solutions are coming.
I just want to thank you all for your time and experiences with the Folio project so far. I really appreciate it, and I the community does as well. thank you all very much.
Yes, thank you all very, very much. And this has been a great session. And our next one starts at the top of the hour, strategies for reducing barriers to adopting open source. And so look forward to that one in about 10 minutes. And so thank you again to our panelists and all of our attendees.
Cheers all, stay safe.
Bye-bye, thanks again. Bye.